Extremely Together is a partnership between One Young World, the Kofi Annan Foundation, with the terrific support of the European Commission. The recent attacks in Baghdad, Dhaka, Nice, Brussels, Lahore, Paris, Mali, and the ongoing foreign fighter phenomenon, the young people who continue to join radical groups such as Daesh and Al-Qaeda, the emergence of far-right extremist groups now in many countries across the world, remind us that the threat from violent extremism is global and generational.
And this program is the brainchild of one of our very first counselors who's passionate about fostering dialogue and leadership among young people by offering a platform where they can express their ideas and propose solutions to the major issues. So please welcome to the stage the 7th Secretary General of the UN, Nobel Peace Prize laureate, a great friend of One Young World and a hero of ours, Kofi Annan.
And with Mr. Annan, 7 young leaders who are fighting extremism around the world, Mr. Annan, scholars of Extremely Together.
It's so great for me to be back here in Ottawa. My name is Ilwad Elman. I was born in Somalia. I came to Canada as a refugee and spent the majority of my life actually in this city right here in Ottawa. So it's a very big moment for me to be back here again. I've been a One Young World ambassador since 2013. I work in Somalia running a national human rights organization called the Elman Peace and Human Rights Center. But today I'm back here in a different capacity as one of the advocates for this initiative that I'm very proud to be a part of called Extremely Together. Extremely Together is a collective of us, 10 young people brought together by the Kofi Annan Foundation and One Young World. Unfortunately, 3 of our colleagues could not be here today, but hopefully we'll be able to represent them adequately. And today we want to tell you guys what Extremely Together is all about. So let's meet some of the leaders that are in this initiative. First, we have my friend and colleague, Bjorn Ihler.
Hi, everyone. Back in 2011, a terrorist pointed his gun at my head and fired. I was a student attending a summer camp that wasn't so different from this camp. It was the camp of the Labour Youth Party in Norway. It was part politics and part socializing. And it was youths from all over Norway, but also international youths attending. Little did I know that less than 24 hours after coming to the camp, my life would change forever. I did not know that I would stumble upon a pile of the bodies of friends who had been executed. I did not know that I would have to hide for more than an hour in the woods with an 8-year-old boy. His father had just gotten killed, holding him down, lying on top of him, covering his mouth while he was screaming out for his father. I did not know that I would end up sitting on the tip of the little island in the middle of peaceful Norway while a man in a police uniform came out of the woods behind me saying that they had captured the bad guy, while around me I could see boats on the water, a helicopter in the air above me, and the man was wearing a police uniform. I believed him. He said they'd caught the bad guy. And then he lifted his gun and started shooting at my group. I jumped straight in the water along with the young boy I'd been hiding with and another young boy we'd picked up at this point, and swam straight outwards where I sank. And I stood up in the water, waiting and looking back towards land, seeing what was happening. And there was Anders Behring Breivik taking aim at my head and firing. For a moment, I thought I was dead. I thought this was my last moment. I came to peace with this being the end. I came to peace with the fact that my life would end after only 20 years. But he missed, and the boys and I managed to swim around a little edge and hide in the water, while Breivik went back up onto the island where he was captured by the police. We lost 69 friends that day on July 22, 2011. We lost 8 more people in the capital of Norway, in Oslo, where Breivik earlier that day had planted a bomb that blew up most of the downtown area, the government headquarters and the central library where I'd been spending a lot of my youth. It was mortifying to see my city in pieces like that. It was mortifying to experience something like that, something that far too many people have to experience far too often on a daily basis in certain places in the world. And this is what drives me. No one should have to experience what I experienced on July 22, 2011. No one should have to experience their friends getting killed, having to go into the funerals of 14-year-olds, of kids who were just attending summer vacation. Breivik was driven by hatred, but his hatred was driven by fear. He was afraid of what he saw as dangerous changes to our society. He was afraid of multiculturalism, of the fact that we could live together in a peaceful, diverse society, something One Young World is a manifestation of. Breivik feared us, and that's why he killed us. But Breivik was also not so different from me. He grew up in the same city as I grew up in a few years before me. His background is not very unique. And what drove him into extremism was fear, but that fear came from somewhere. And it came from the stories Breivik believed in. It came from the society we lived in and from the stories that exist in our society. And I believe it's all our responsibility to stand extremely together against those stories, to show that unity is the way forward, that we can live together in diverse societies without being afraid of each other, regardless of where we are from, what we believe in, who we love. We can stand together, and we can all, each and one, every one of us, take responsibility in our lives to challenge extremism by helping those who are afraid, by making everyone comfortable and befriend everyone. Thank you very much.
Thank you much. I'd like to welcome my colleague Hassan Ndugwa now to share his personal story with us.
On the fateful evening of July 11th, 2010, I joined 3 of my colleagues at the Chadondo rugby grounds in Kampala to watch the World Cup finals match that was being broadcasted live from South Africa on giant screens. Little did I know that this was about to turn out as the darkest moment of my life. As we enjoyed the game and the music that was playing all night, towards the 78th minute, I heard the loudest sound of my life. Boom. Looking on my left-hand side, all I could see was a huge dark smoke. Looking at the girls around me, the beautiful young girls with whom I was chatting with, I could not recognize them anymore as their beautiful bodies were all in pieces. I started running for my life, but as I ran towards the exit, another blast. I saw people falling like rain as they all ran towards the exit. I continued running, and I thought I'd survived it. Looking at myself, I was in a pool of blood. Blood was flowing all over me, in my shoes, in my boxers, and on my shirt. I continued running towards the main exit. I was advised by a few people who are concerned with my situation to get into the car, which was taking other people who were injured to hospital. Good enough, I was taken to hospital. When I reached hospital, I saw bodies flocking in. I saw people in halves. I had a lot of human flesh all over my body. I could not understand the situation. Good enough, I was stitched very well on my left cheek. And the following morning, I was discharged. Watching the news while I was home, the extremist group Al-Shabaab claimed responsibility of the attack, and Muslim youth were paraded as suspects and accomplices to this attack. This left me puzzled, asking myself so many questions. Why would someone believe that when you kill someone, you get a direct passport to heaven? Why would a 17-year-old in a tough neighborhood sign up to a gang? Why would a young person abandon their life and future to join terrorist groups that preach supremacy? For me, that was the beginning of my engagement with preventing violent extremism. Together with a colleague that I survived with, we formed the Uganda Muslim Youth Development Forum as an organization to prevent violent extremism in the East African region. And with the Uganda Muslim Youth Development Forum, we are able to reach 10,000 young people through direct training to reduce their susceptibility to violent extremist recruitment. And we are also able to engage religious leaders to ensure that they spread the message of peace and that the mosques are used as centers of development other than breeding areas for terrorist recruitment. I'm with Extremely Together today because I believe my experience is not unique. I believe my work with Uganda Muslim Youth Development Forum needs to reach other areas of the world. It needs to be replicated. Thank you so much.
Wow. Thank you. Hajer Sharief, thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm Hajer Sharief. I'm coming from Libya. Usually when you want to know someone, you ask them two questions. What's your name? You get to know that, and then you ask them, what do you do for a living? And what I do for a living is that I'm a full-time war survivor. Since 2011, and perhaps most of you have heard of the Libyan Revolution and the revolutions that happen in North Africa and the Middle East. Unfortunately, when it came to the Libyan Revolution, it first started as peaceful protests, demonstrations. People were calling for democracy, freedom of speech, human rights, etc. It only took us less than a month to see that those peaceful protests turned to a bloody war. After 6 months from the war, I volunteered to work at Tripoli Central Hospital. And the first patient I got to meet in my first day, it was an old man, late of his 70s. And that man wasn't injured from a bullet in the streets, in the armed conflict in itself, or the fights that were taking in different parts of the country. That man was actually injured by a shrapnel, which is mainly that he was going in one evening to the grocery store, and then there was an airstrike that hit the same area where he was going. And within the global policies or the experts of war and security, what they call this incident, they just call it, well, this man was in the wrong time, the wrong place. And then for me at that time, I wondered, how can someone going to a store in the evening can be a wrong time in the wrong place? So seeing that was a waking up call for me to start working more on peace and security. And I just realized that the war didn't actually end. The war has just started. So I co-founded an organization called the Together We Build It organization, where we work mainly with young women, youth, and women on their participation in the peace-building process, security sector reform, peace negotiation, and mainly we hold trainings all over the country where we tackle the issue of violence. Violence on all levels, family level, community level, national level, global level. So that was mainly the golden era of my time, where I felt, honestly, that I'm participating in rebuilding a country. You know, when you had those history classes and you hear about those people of your own nations who build a country, that was me during that time. And then, 19th of September 2014, I was just like anyone else, woke up in the morning, and I was scrolling through my Facebook. And I saw in news that a dear friend of mine, who wasn't even 18 at that time, was assassinated by an extremist group. And my same friend, he called me 3 days before he was killed, and he asked me to write a joint article to a regional newspaper where we will talk about the role of the society in peace building. So he was like, I will take the part of youth and you will take the part of gender and women. And I literally remember myself telling him, do you really think such a thing would work? Do you think civic work during war is going to make any difference? And I remember something that I will never forget, despite the fact that he was living in Benghazi, and that's the most affected city by the war in Libya, until this moment, he said, civil work never ends, only the war should end. Yesterday, Sir Bob asked a question. He asked, aren't we all tired? And you should have seen me. I was that first grade kid who knew the answer the teacher asked. And I was like, yes. But for me, honestly, I'm not tired from seeing blood, seeing people killed, hearing that my friends are being kidnapped, other activists, more than I'm tired from the silence. The silence that I'm seeing in my own country, the silence that I'm seeing in other countries, and the silence that I'm seeing all around the world. And most ironically, even the way we honor those who sacrificed their lives, for me to stand here, for you to be here, we tend to honor them with a minute of silence. Can you just believe it? A moment of silence. We are promoting for more silence, despite the fact that they were killed because they weren't silent. So today, I would ask you all, please, to stand up and join me. And let's all be extremely together, and let's promise ourselves that we won't be silent anymore. Let's make this day, this moment, a moment where we make a promise that the only thing that we will do is that we will always stand up together and always be extremely together. Thank you.
This right here, our session just started, and I hope you're already beginning to see what Extremely Together is about. These three people epitomize to me what we hope to impart on all of you, that it's so easy to choose hate, to choose divide. They've undergone atrocious circumstances, but harness their unique experiences to create a more enabling and progressive environment in their own respective communities. They chose love and unity and promoting peace when it was so easy to turn to hate. And that is what Extremely Together is about. I learned something from Hassan. The attack that he was a victim of is actually an example of how broad we have to look at this entire issue of countering violent extremism. We can't be too narrow in our interventions. The bomb that was used in the attack in Uganda was made in Tanzania, transported through Kenya, and then used in an attack in Uganda, a transnational network. So when we look at this issue, we have to look at it from a bigger picture. And that's what Extremely Together is about. We all have very different focuses, but it all comes together in a holistic approach, grounded on being together and unity. I want to show you a video that's made by Bjorn, one of our advocates here, that I think depicts exactly what we hope to get across when we talk about countering extremism. And this is breaking the cycle of hate. We often hear about the role of young people in building peace and how important they are. When we talk about countering violent extremism, for too long the narrative has been that young people are either perpetrators or potential perpetrators. And we look at them as a great resource for possibly solving this issue, but we don't engage them meaningfully. And what I find most unique about Extremely Together is that it's leveraging activists from the grassroots and mentoring them and linking them with world leaders, people that have a world platform. It's a huge honor for me to be sitting next to Mr. Kofi Annan, who needs no introduction himself, but for him to leverage and activate his own networks to ensure that our voices are heard, that we are at this proverbial decision-making table. It's one of the unique initiatives that exist that actually focuses on leveraging and breaking down those silos that exist. Countering extremism has for too long been looked at just from a security lens, when there's opportunity to look at it from a development lens and from a peace-building lens as well, too. And we have the opportunity to hear from Mr. Kofi Annan on what is the way forward. Just in a few segments that we've heard already, we've listened about right-wing terror, politically motivated violence, and radical jihadi extremism. And as much as there are so much differences in ideologies, there are also very real similarities. And we are seeing this universally with global attacks happening more and more frequent. I'd like to ask you, Mr. Kofi Annan, we see different reactions to different attacks in different parts of the world. What can we learn from these similarities between the groups and ideologies responsible for violent extremism attacks carried out across the world?
Thank you very much, Chair. But before I answer your question, let me share a story. You started by saying Kofi Annan, a man who doesn't need any introduction. You know, once my wife and I went on holidays and we wanted to walk around incognito. And suddenly we saw a group of five men staring at us, and one of them broke and made for me. And I said to my wife, we have a few weeks to go and we've broken our cover. How are we going to have a quiet holidays and not be bothered by the village? By then, the fellow was on top of me, and he put his hand out and said, Morgan Freeman. May I have an autograph? And I said, sure. So I signed K. Freeman. He was very happy, and we were very happy and continued our holidays incognito. But it teaches you not to go around thinking everybody knows you and you don't need introduction, you know. But I think the issue we are discussing here is an extremely important one in our world of today. It's global, it's transgenerational, it affects every society. There was a period when we thought it was concentrated in one region of the world. Today, as we've seen, it can hit any country, any region, at any time, and locations we don't expect, schools, churches. So we are all in this together, and we need to find a way of countering it. The world's population is young. 30% of that population, 50% of that population is under 30 years old. And you have to become engaged and help us deal with this issue. You have to do it your own way, in your own communities. And honestly, it doesn't have to be a big act. Mm-hmm. You know, it sometimes is enough to see somebody being bullied and to stop and say, enough, we won't take it anymore. You cannot treat this person this way. You have no idea what that does to the victim. When an interested third party intervenes, it gives them courage, it gives them strength to fight back. And we need to speak up. We need to react. I know people are sometimes intimidated because those perpetrating the violence are brutal. And some people think if they speak up, they may be attacked. But we have to have the courage to speak up and not allow a small group to intimidate a whole nation or hijack a whole religion and allow them to get away with it because of silence, because we don't speak up.
Mm-hmm. So then what's, I think the question that's on a lot of people's minds is, what is the right way to engage them in the space of countering violent extremism? Because my line of work is on the rehabilitation and reintegration and disengagement of youth fighters. And often, the question that I'm posed with is this too soft of an approach? Our rationale in Somalia is less fighters, less fighting. And we believe that we can reach those that are directly involved with armed groups. But one of the things that young people, and myself particularly, I'm always met with is that young people have to fit in a certain box when it comes to countering extremism. Peer-to-peer engagement, volunteer work, sports and arts, all very important things, but it's as though governments, in the most part, decide what space young people can really lead, and the hard sectors are often debated. So I'd like to ask you, is there a right or wrong way to counter violent extremism, and what does the ideal reaction to it look like?
No, I don't think we... There is a tendency in some quarters to say, let's use force, that you have to use force to counter terrorism. I think you also have to use ideas, you have to use education, you have to encourage understanding and also reconciliation. Sometimes it's because people are alienated, people are desperate, that they become prone to being recruited by extremist groups. So your point is right, we need to tackle it at various levels, at the level of education, at the level of economic and social development, to reduce the despair, the depravity that sometimes pushes people to take actions that they would normally not take. We should also, within our own communities and societies, discuss these issues and be supportive of each other. There is safety in numbers. If we stand together and we work together, we all feel much stronger and are able to take it on. When you look at some of the regions where we've seen extremism take hold, the people are extremely poor, and sometimes these people using violence for power, it's often also political. They pretend it's religious, and often religion has nothing to do with it. And all of us, I don't know, there are many in this room who are religious, go to the mosque, go to church, or pray. But each of the major religions teaches us the same thing. Be merciful, be kind to your brother and sister, don't steal, don't lie. So religion, in a way, is education in social morality. How can we go and kill and pretend we're doing it in the name of a religion? But the point is, when this small group takes over and use violence to kill and claim they are doing it in the name of this or that religion, the majority don't speak up because we are scared or we don't want to get involved, and they get away with it and it escalates. So the idea of standing up and speaking up is extremely important.
Yes, absolutely. And I think that for the most part, we would agree that you can't bomb an ideology, and dialogue and fostering real relationships with the communities that are affected by violent extremism is the strongest entry point for real change. What can young leaders in this room today, and those unable to be with us here but following us on the live stream, practically do to countering violent extremism in their own communities?
I think we have already had three wonderful examples of what young people are doing and can do. And I would urge those in this room to think and think hard about what they can do, what contribution they can make in their own community to explain that there's more that unites us than divides us, to explain that today we live in pluralistic, humane societies, and we need to celebrate our diversity rather than turning on each other. And in fact, I know the movements of people across borders, migration, refugees, and others have raised tensions. But unfortunately, whether we like it or not, migration is going to continue. We've been walking and migrating since the beginning. And recently, a group of scientists have worked together. Three different researchers came to the same conclusion, that migration started from one single a migration, 50,000 to 80,000 years ago in Africa. We are all sons and daughters of Lucy, and we've been moving on since then, and so migration will continue, and we have to learn how we handle, manage the migration in a manner that is in the interest of everybody. We need to reach out to the other, and we should be careful not to be so concerned to divide the world into the other and me, and often we demonize the other. We need to avoid the tendency to demonize the other. Once you've demonized the other person, you can do whatever you want and you feel justified. You know, and I often tell people to remember that even a heinous crime like genocide begins with the humiliation of one individual. It begins with humiliation of one individual and it takes on. And so do what you can as individuals, as small groups in your own community to try and stop some of these things. Don't leave it to governments alone. Governments have responsibility, companies have responsibility, NGOs, and we as individuals have responsibility. So let's all work together to stop this.
Thank you very much. Yeah. We have to, what I take away from that message is we have to break down the silos. We have to get rid of this mentality of us against them. We have to stand up for what brings us together, what we believe in, and not just stand up for what we are against. Let's highlight the positive things that young people are doing together. So I want to invite my friends and colleagues, Arizza and Hassan, to come up with me, and let's talk about Extremely Together. What is all the hype about? What are we doing? What are our values? What are we about? We want you guys to join this movement because we believe we are on the brink of something phenomenal. We are always looked at as young people, as the perpetrators, the group that is most involved, the victims. This is a solution for us to actually act in what I believe to be the most pressing concern of our generation. Hassan, please.
Yeah, we are 10 young people from different parts of the world. Mr. Kofi Annan had a vision to bring us together to lead the way and preventing violent extremism in the world. We are extremely together and we take a value-based approach to preventing violent extremism. Today, we are here with the energies of 2 billion young people all over the world. We are here with the passion of millions and billions of young people all over the world. Our work as Extremely Together focuses on inspiring young people with the work that we do and the great work that others are doing in preventing violent extremism. We hope to engage all of you here to see that we form a movement that will lead the work on preventing violent extremism. We hope to empower you with the tools and methods such that you will build your capacities to prevent violent extremism in the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Hassan. Hi, I'm Arizza, and I'm from the Philippines. And I'm one out of these 10 young leaders here today who are part of Extremely Together. These 10 exceptional leaders are here today because not for ourselves, not for Mr. Kofi Annan, but for you. In fact, 3 of our Extremely Together young leaders cannot be here today. They're from Syria, Pakistan, and Nigeria, precisely because of issues of violent extremism that countries like Canada are sensitive about. That's why we're not complete. So, since we're lacking, we want you to complete us. If we're a group of 10, I want you to look at the 10 people in your row or in your column. Look at 10 people. Look exactly at the faces of 10 people around you right now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Those faces are your Extremely Together group. So it's not us being here on stage telling you that we are extremely together. No, extremely together is this. This whole group and the whole 2 billion young people under 30 in this world, but you're extremely responsible for us being extremely together because we're launching this today on One Young World. So you have to listen closely. So what is Extremely Together? So I'd like to share three things I believe make Extremely Together extra special. Number one, we want to make young people feel extremely responsible for acts of violent extremism. Not because you're the ones who do it, not because your countries may be experiencing violent extremism, because young people in general, fighters of the Islamic State, rebels all over the world, militants and separatist groups, they're not actually made up now of majority older generations. They're made up of young people like us. Last year, when Sir Bob Geldof went up on stage, grumpy as usual, he pointed the finger at us and he said, "The attack in Paris just happened. Hundreds of people were killed. It's your fault. It's your generation's fault. So do something about it." We have to feel responsible for this because, to be honest, I believe our governments, our armies, our states, our policymakers are not doing enough. And they're not capable of doing what we are capable of doing. Because I think, and I believe, peace starts from the ground up, not from the government or from leadership down. It starts right here. So we have to feel extremely responsible. Number two, I hope that we feel extremely positive. Every time there is an incident of violent extremism or terror in any of our countries, in any of our communities, I hope that we respond with empathy and hope and understanding rather than fear, hatred, anger, discrimination. Last year, I was here on stage as a delegate speaker, and I was talking about my experience of being in the Philippines, which has been experiencing conflict. We have a majority Catholic population in the Philippines with a Muslim minority, and the Muslim minority has been historically oppressed. That's why a lot of Muslim young people now are taking up arms to rise up against government and to rise up against the status quo. There has been violence, there has been kidnappings, beheadings, bombs, but to be honest, I can't respond with fear, anger, or hatred because I know and I understand, I try to understand where they are coming from. They're coming from a situation where they're discriminated against because their names are Muhammad or Noor or something. They can't get jobs, they can't get decent jobs in the Philippines. They live in areas that have extreme poverty. They don't have enough jobs. They don't get enough access to education. And these are the factors that make them feel angry. And we can't respond their anger with another anger. We can't fight fire with fire. We have to respond extremely positively.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And that's exactly what Extremely Together is about. Let's highlight the important roles that young people are taking in this space to create positive solutions, not ones that are radicalizing the innocent or marginalizing them, but creating opportunities. And this is an opportunity for us to also talk about what our colleagues are doing back home. We have Zaid from Syria, who's currently living in Abu Dhabi. He runs several businesses, and he provides employment for refugees. He looks at this issue as not just refugees are not a problem. They are fleeing their homes because of conflict. Yes. And he's providing a tangible solution. And there's a beautiful poem that I always think about when I think of Zaid's work that was written by Worsen Shearer, where she says, "No one leaves home unless home is the mouth of a shark." We also have young people, 500 young people actually, who applied to be part of Extremely Together. We are just the lucky few that are standing here before you today that have had the opportunity to be working closely on this, but this is an initiative that belongs to all young people and all young people can be a part of. There are so many examples of young people leading in this space that this narrative that we constantly keep hearing about is young people as a problem or just a benefactor or beneficiary of solutions that come from governments and older people is played out. So we are trying to fix with Extremely Together is having a clearly defined role. So what we are working on that I think is very exciting is a toolkit. It's not just more ink on paper, a clear step-to-step guide of how young people can get involved. I often have young people reaching out to me, whether it's on social media or through different interactions I have with them, saying that working with the UN or international bodies or working in the space of global security is incredibly closed for young people. It's difficult to break into. And then they become disillusioned. But the call to action for joining extremist groups is very easy. Book this flight, take this gun, join this cause, you're part of something. So why is it so hard for young people who want to create a positive change in their societies to just be pushed out constantly because they don't have enough experience, because they're not old enough, they don't have the right networks? Well, that's what Extremely Together aims to bond together, linking world leaders with young people and creating real opportunities for them to be heard and to act, and matching resources to the wide rhetoric that we constantly hear about young people needing to be in this space. Let's take a look at a video that I think depicts just what is happening in our world today. In all the different parts of it, we are all affected by violent extremism, but we all have an opportunity to create real change in this space as well, too. We need to break the cycle of hate. I want everyone to get their phones out. Does everyone have a phone, smartphone, connected? Let's get Extremely Together right now. Let's take an action. Let's be proactive. So I want everyone to search Extremely Together on Twitter. Retweet our pinned tweet now. Let's do that first. So Extremely Together on Twitter is X-T-R-E-M-E-L-Y, number 2, get her. That's our first action. Search us on Facebook and share the video that we've created with your followers. Let's get this message outside of this room, outside of those that are plugged in on a live stream, and reach globally. We got it? We're also on Instagram. Is this on internet? Oh, boo. Save it. We'll give you guys the links after. And there's a booth that we have set up as well, too, that you can get more information and more content. Now I'd like to invite my dear friends, Fatima and Mimoun, to also give us more of a practical guide on what the next steps are.
Thank you. So we are on world stage now. Do you feel this energy? It's like this power in this hall. One Young World, are you Extremely Together?
We can't hear you.
Are you Extremely Together?
Together. Yes.
So
good.
My name is Mimoun. I founded an NGO on the field of radicalization prevention in Germany, and I joined Extremely Together because I really believe that change is only possible through young people. So the most effective group of people who can help young people who are affected by extremist groups are young people themselves.
And I'm Fatima Zaman, and I'm from the UK. You'll hear more about my work in the next session, but I joined Extremely Together because I am sick. I am tired of being told, you are the problem. If it's my problem, if it's our problem, let us own the problem and let us provide the solution. We are the solution.
So
that is what Extremely Together is about.
So Fatima, we heard about the harm caused by extremism, and also we heard about what Extremely Together is all about. But what will happen next? Something is missing. Like, we will leave Ottawa and...
No, Mimoun, we do not go home. You do not come to One Young World to merely listen. You do not come to One Young World to leave empty-handed. You come to One Young World. 1,300 young leaders come to One Young World to take action. Change happens now. And it's not just merely sharing a tweet or a hashtag. We want you to take and channel your action. We have, Ilwad mentions, we have a booth outside. Now, we want you to make a video pledge. We want you to go in 2x2 with all your colleagues and say, we support Extremely Together. We are united in the face of hate, and we will send a message, a direct message to the extremists. We will set about a chain reaction that is cataclysmic.
As soon as you make the pledge, we will spread it through all our social media channels and try to reach everyone. And after that, you can nominate everyone, like your friend, your classmates, your Facebook friends, your grandfather, even your president.
Why not?
Why not? And we will do the pledge together.
Yep.
So my name is Mimoun. I'm from Germany.
My name is Fatima, and I'm from the UK.
We are Extremely Together, and we want to break the cycle of hate.
That is the first action. 1,300 of you through that booth in the next 48 hours. Let us break the internet. Let us break the cycle of hate, and let us send a direct message. We are Extremely Together. These extremists cannot bring us down.
And
time and time and again, we have seen extremist attacks take place. We have a standard routine response. The media breaks the news. We sympathize with the victims, and we take a minute of silence. Silence and a minute is not enough. We need real action. It is inevitable that extremist attacks will happen. As we are speaking, something is happening across the world. Someone is running for their lives. Someone is being terrorized. But we will have a different response the next time we see an extremist attack. We will respond extremely together with action. Join our movement. We are 10 young people empowered by Mr. Annan. The 10 of us are empowering you 1,300. You 1,300 will go to your home communities and empower another 1,300. That 1,300 will energize and charge and activate 1.8 billion people across the world. Imagine the power we have. Imagine what we can do.
We will be a global movement, and Extremely Together will become extremely active. We will try to have activities and projects everywhere in every corner of the world. And it's possible, and we will do that after you have taken the pledge. So please sign up on our website and go to the booth. But my last question would be, Fatima, whom are you going to nominate today? Maybe, so.
Mimoun, I nominate this man in the red tie. I'm calling on you. We met yesterday. And you promised me, you said you would take an action. So I'm calling on you. I'm calling on Kate and I'm calling on Dave. I'm calling on the counselors of One Young World. I'm calling on Emma Watson, our latest counselor. Get into that booth. Make a pledge in whatever language you want, but do something now. Otherwise, it will be too late. Time is running out. The extremists have a head start, but we have power, peace, and right on our side. There are too many of us and too little of them. Let us drown them out and let us beat them with our ideas of peace and hate. But Extremely Together doesn't just stop with a pledge. We are creating a toolkit designed to let you have the resources that we have. We are 10 people, and we are creating, and we will lead you, and we will train you so that you can stay in Ottawa, have the toolkit in the coming months, and then go back to your home countries so that you can spread the message of peace and the message of Extremely Together, so that you can become the leaders. You can become Extremely Together ambassadors, and you will reach the 1.8 billion young people in the world who the extremists are preying on, who the extremists are wanting to recruit. And you will save them and build resilience and bring us all together. The responsibility is on you now.
So let's make the pledge and let's be Extremely Together and let's be active.
Yes. Join us and be Extremely Together.
It's an incredibly exciting time we are in as young people right now. We have the new UN Security Resolution 2250 on youth, peace, and security. There's a global youth action agenda on countering violent extremism. There's the Amman Declaration on peace and security and the role of young people that's just recently been adopted. We have a toolkit that's going to be launched soon. You have people like Kofi Annan leveraging his networks, activating his networks to ensure that you can go home in your community and make sure that you can create the change in society that you want to see. We have a step-by-step guide and resources to match that. There's no reason for us not to take action. Extremism is a social ill, but it affects us all. We heard just today from three different people of how it affects them in their very three different contexts. We have a call to action today, and we hope that you'll answer it. It's been a pleasure working with these advocates and learning from Kofi Annan on how best to engage in my community. And this is a space that we want to open up to all of you. Thank you very much for listening to us today. And I'd love to hear some ending thoughts from our mentor.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Good morning. You've now heard and met 10 amazing young leaders who are on the front line of the most difficult challenges that we face. This is a global struggle. This is a generational struggle. And led by these 10 young leaders, it is up to you and your peers to bring unity to your communities around the world and challenge extremist voices. Show terrorists what we are for and not what we are against. Support Extremely Together by being extremely sure of our shared values, tolerance, inclusion, gender equality, religious freedom. These can unite us all. We have heard about some of the amazing steps that the young people are taking to counter extremism. Now we must all unite for this common cause and bring these efforts together to build a world free of divisive and fearful voices. You can support Extremely Together by coming together to build bridges between and within communities of young peoples across the globe. That can start now. Come along to Extremely Together booth in Perth and make a pledge of action. As you've heard the appeal, and I'm supporting that appeal. And most importantly, where some may see youth as a problem, I am convinced that young people are the key to this threat. So I urge you to stop asking to be listened to. It is time for you to act. The Extremely Together young leaders have told me about what they do with the civil society from civil society position. Follow their example. You don't need governments, but you do need to support each other. Join Extremely Together. Join the Extremely Together movement, and we will together counter extremism. Thank you, my friends.
Thank you so much. A huge round of applause for the Extremely Together delegates and for Kofi Annan.